Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Star. Today is going to be kind of like Bailey Sarian's Murder, Makeup, and Mystery Mondays, but it's not about true crime. It's just about interesting things I find online, something like the paranormal and things that happen that we can't explain, some conspiracy theories maybe. I still don't know what to name this series, but I am very interested in it and I hope you are too. So today we're going to be talking about Valentine's Day and doing our makeup at the same time, just like Bailey Sarian does. Quick disclaimer, I am not a historian. I am not at all an expert on this field. So if I do get some details wrong, please feel free to comment down below. I will have all the articles linked down below as well. That's Moo Moo, by the way. He's a cow. So let's begin with the Feast of Lupercalia. The Feast of Lupercalia was a Roman celebration back in the 6th century BC. So that was a long time ago. Some accounts say it's celebrated on the 15th of February, but some say it's like between the 13th to the 15th. But anyway, it was around that time. So the Romans, they would start the celebration by sacrificing a male goat. The male goat would kind of symbolize the male sexuality. And they would also sacrifice a dog. They would do this to ward off evil spirits. Not only did they do this, but they also whipped naked women. They would whip naked women, and the women welcomed the whippings because they believed that it would mean a healthy birth or fertility. And again, this was 6th century BC, so it was a long time ago. This was later outlawed, but I will be getting to that in a second. Let's divert to Valentine. There were a few recorded Valentines in that period who were executed or who died during that time, and this was in the 3rd century AD. So don't worry, I'm gonna give the timelines later. It'll all be clearer later. I burned my nose. There's like a burn mark over there. Let's ignore that. Let's pretend it's not real. So there were three martyrs recorded by the name of Valentine or Valentini who died during that period, which was the 3rd century AD. Take note that the 3rd century AD basically was the period between the year 201 to 300. So now it's like 2021. So you get the picture. So this was during the time where Emperor Claudius II was reigning. And Christian persecution was very common during this time. Emperor Claudius II, he did not like Christians. Valentine was said to be a Roman priest, and there were a lot of different like accounts of who he was and what he was doing. Lots of legends about him surrounding his life and his death. But the most common, can't seem to let that go away. Just try to ignore that. So the most common legends were Valentine was a Roman priest and he would secretly assist the Christians who were persecuted. And he would be marrying the Christian couples who were in love in secret. And remember, Christianity wasn't something that Emperor Claudius II approved of. Valentine would be marrying soldiers in secret, and some accounts say that the emperor did not approve of soldiers getting into like affairs of the heart because the emperor thinks that love is associated with weakness and he did not want weak soldiers. So guess what? Valentine was found and he was sent to jail. Oh my gosh, there's something in my eye. He was put under the watchful eye of an aristocrat named Asterius. I keep saying Asterius. While he was with Asterius, they were chatting and talking a lot, I guess. And I mean, Valentine being a Roman priest, of course he's gonna try to convert the guy who is his jailer, basically. So Asterius was like, you know what? I have a daughter who's blind. If you can heal her, my whole family's gonna convert to Christianity. Valentine gave it a try. And lo and behold, he was able to heal Asterius' daughter and give back her sight, which is amazing. So Asterius was like, wow, My whole family is gonna convert. So they all converted into Christianity. Guess who found out? The emperor found out that the guy who he let Valentine be jailed by, he found out that all his whole family is now Christians. So what do you expect? He put them all to jail and he had them all executed, but the emperor wanted to have Valentine denounce his faith first. But Valentine did not denounce his faith. And because of that, he was beheaded. And this was on February 14th during the 3rd century. So I don't know how Bailey does this. Well, she talks about stuff and her makeup still looks amazing because I'm distracted and I feel like my makeup's not turning out very well, but we'll try it anyway. So Valentine was beheaded on the 14th of February, 3rd century AD. He was around early to mid 40s. So let's revert back to the Feast of Lupercalia. Remember, 6th century BC, the feast was going on. And then Valentine was executed on the 3rd century AD. So it's been going on for a while. And people have been celebrating this feast for a while. And fast forward to the 5th century AD. Pope Galatius I was like, it's the 5th century. We're still doing this pagan celebration. Let's outlaw it. So he outlawed the pagan celebration. In its stead, he decided to celebrate the 14th of February in honor of the martyrdom of Valentine. I guess it's a coincidence that, you know, the pagan celebration was on the like 14th or 15th and Valentine was executed on the 14th. I don't know if it was like a cover-up or if it was just a coincidence, a convenient coincidence. But that's what happened. Okay, so now how did Valentine's Day become Valentine's Day, the big industry it is today? Well, fast forward maybe 1,000 years after Valentine died. You might be familiar with a poet called Geoffrey Chaucer. And you might know him because he is considered the greatest English poet of the Middle Ages. And he wrote the Canterbury Tales. It was widely believed by the Europeans that during the month of February, birds would start their mating season. Why am I talking like this? Mating seasons typically start during springtime, which typically start in March, but maybe in other countries it starts sooner. So he wrote a poem, a very famous poem. It was called The Parliament of Fowls. He wrote, "For this was sent on Saint Valentine's Day, when every fowl cometh there to choose his mate." So being the famous poet that he was during that time, of course, the European nobility would kind of follow suit and would start sending their loved ones like poems and notes and love letters. And I mean, anything the nobility does, everybody would kind of do. Kind of like right now, if Kim Kardashian does something, we'll all want to do it as well. The nobilities, they were like the influencers of that century. And Valentine's Day kind of got more and more popular. And so people in the markets were like, ooh, we can actually capitalize on this. Maybe we can make like, you know, little chocolate covered hearts or something. So they did that. But wait, where does Cupid fall in all of this? What happened to Cupid? So this is completely separate from the whole Valentine's thing. So back in 700 BC, the Greek literature, Greek mythology has this god named Eros. And Eros was, it's translated to desire. Eros is the son of, you guessed it, Aphrodite, the Greek goddess of love and beauty and passion. And so she had a son, his name was Eros. And Eros was depicted as this handsome, charming teenage boy. And nobody liked him because he would play with the hearts of gods and mortals, and just because he wants to. And he would just cause a lot of mayhem. And people were afraid of him because whatever he wants to have done will be done. And even if you hate the person with all your might, or you love somebody else, you can't run away from Eris's powers. So this was the original Eros, the original Cupid. And as time went by, the character of Eros started to change a little. The character started to develop into this younger boy who was under his mother's like guidance. And he would only act based on what his mother wants him to do, or based on Aphrodite's wishes. He became less intimidating and more likable. And so, as Greek literature was just kind of falling and the Roman literature was kind of growing, the Romans were like, huh, I like this character. I'm gonna develop this character, make it Roman, rename Eros to Cupid, which also translates to desire, and rename his mom Aphrodite to Venus. The character of Cupid was born, and he was depicted as a younger child, an actual child of Aphrodite. So, you know, stories just continue to evolve. And so when the Renaissance came, people were like, how do we portray Cupid? And painters started to show him in this little baby boy form with tiny wings and a bow and arrow, you know, to shoot people with. He became more and more likable as the god of pure love, purity and innocence and pure love, and who would bring people together. Fast forward hundreds of years later, naturally, the god of love and Valentine's Day, they would cross paths. So that happened. And we've had our postal reforms, there's been the Industrial Revolution, and then the invention of the printing press. I mean, people started to get more and more advanced. And so in 1916, a company, and I'm pretty sure you know this company, they have movies now, Hallmark, decided to mass produce their Valentine's Day cards. I mean, people can get Valentine's Day cards through post now. Accessibility is really one of the prime reasons why Valentine's Day became such a huge industry. And so now, fast forward several years later, Valentine's Day is a multi-billion dollar industry. I still remember back in the day when the internet was still like doing the, we would exchange Valentine's Day e-cards, and now it's like nobody does that anymore. That is it. If you enjoyed today, and if you'd like to see me do more of this in the future, then please consider subscribing, like this video if you found it helpful, and comment down below what you'd like to hear about next. So thank you so much for watching. I hope to see you in my next video. Bye!